live in 2 minutes. Welcome to Lynn Cullen Live at pghcitypaper.com. Email your questions and comments to Lynn at pghcitypaper.com.
I'll tell you, what a world, what a world. It's amazing. We take it for granted. Here am I sitting 21 stories into the air looking at a whiteout outside my window, and yet I'm able to speak to my younger sister who's thousands of miles away sitting in the desert in California, and we take this for granted. Suze, hi.
Hi.
How are you?
Well, I'm fine. I hear that you've got beautiful snow swirling about you.
Yes, indeed, it is. It's sort of light snow, but it's it's right now. You can't tell the sky from the air. That doesn't make sense.
But I know what you mean.
You do?
Sort of.
What did I mean? I was I was looking out and saw, you know, the sky is just totally sort of white gray.
Right.
And then in front of it I see the snow and it's turning. Never mind.
Well, out here, what you will see is the beginning of a beautiful, sunny, perfect, cloudless, you know, about 83 degrees.
Yeah. See it. I'm there tomorrow, Suze.
Good.
Woo!
I washed towels.
Good. I want clean towels. I want clean sheets. I want a little, some nice lounge chair underneath the palm tree, and I'm done.
You're there.
All right. So, listen. All right. We gotta, this is my last show for a week, so we gotta, talk. Seriously.
Well, that's fine. I did a little review of the New York Times this morning and managed to get myself irritated without any trouble.
Yeah, good. Okay, I am starting what is going to be, I fear, a long trudge trying to get my head around who I'm supposed to. It's a Bernie and Hillary thing. It's really hard on me. He says everything that I've been saying for years, and yet my pragmatic gut tells me he ain't going to win a general. And I'm really, really, really struggling. And in the course of sharing my struggles with the audience, I'm now starting to get emails. It's going to be, yow. Let me see. Oh, I've knocked them off. That's just great. I knocked it off. But people are saying things like, no, you know, you voted, you said a vote for Nader was like the, and it's true. I said yesterday, I have still been screaming at people who voted for Nader giving Florida to Bush. And I'm getting,
well, that's a different situation.
Well, I don't
that's
know. I'm getting, what? I'm getting a lot of emails.
Yeah.
From people saying, don't you get it? A vote for Bernie Sanders is like a Nader vote again. You're right. It's a different than this third party. But, I mean, it's so then I'm also getting a lot of McGovern. Don't
well,
you see?
That's how I feel about it. I do feel that way about it. And at the same time, I think that it's too early to panic. Let this primary process
play out.
I think that, honestly, if we can put the hysteria away, what Bernie and Hillary are doing is having one of the most intelligent conversations leading up to these votes that the American people has been treated to in a long time. There are real differences between them, but they are both candidates that can get us where we're going. I'm Hillary. I'm Hillary just because I think she's got just a wealth of experience. I think she's smart. I think it's time to have a woman president, and I think she's a better shot at winning. And so to me, that means I vote for Hillary. But I can see coming to the other side saying, why aren't I voting for all the things that I believed in all along that he is so clearly stating? You know, I get it.
Yeah, this is tough.
It's very tough. But I'm pragmatic, just like she is.
I'm pragmatic, too. Always have been.
I'd rather see what we could get done instead of...
Well, why would we get anything Why would we get anything more done than we've gotten with Obama? I mean, you'll have a totally recalcitrant Republican Congress. Of course, the same would happen if Sanders were in. Can't have no revolution with a Republican Congress. I don't know.
Can I just tell you what irritated me out of the Republican Congress today?
Do I know about it?
Well, probably.
Yes.
It was their refusal to, they are not inviting Obama's budget director.
Right.
To present his budget. So that's stupid and awful and all that stuff. But what bothered me is their characterization of why would we listen to this guy anyway? He's representing the president that was in charge of the worst recovery ever.
What?
It's this Republican speak. That's a quote out of the New York Times. The worst recovery either. Somebody tell me what is the worst recovery ever. The worst recovery ever would be no recovery.
God.
If by definition we have a recovery, because you're using the word, of a situation caused by your Republican president.
Unbelievable. And your Republican policies, handing over no regulation of banks and the financial industry, giving them everything. I mean, oh, my God.
You're fighting him. Wait a minute. And you're fighting him every step of the way and closing down the government two or three times in the process.
Yeah.
And you're faulting the president for the, quote, worst,
God.
Unquote,
well,
recovery
right.
ever.
Yeah.
So that's what got my blood boiling. This
yeah.
Just
well,
wanted
that...
to throw that out there.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I want you to, something else that I talked about yesterday, and I want you to, did you happen to see Bill Maher on this weekend, Friday, Saturday?
No, but I know, but I have since been.
You know what Steinem said. I mean, I was watching with.
My jaw dropped.
I was watching with my son. And I don't even think we could believe we heard what she said. I mean, it was like, what? You know, she's an icon of mine. I mean, I so look up to her. And she's so smooth and smart and everything. What the f- Anyway, and then the next day, Madeleine Albright shows up on the stump in New Hampshire and tells young women that if they're not voting for Hillary, she wants them to know there's a special place in hell for women who don't support other women.
Okay, so what, you know, Madeline's got me even more irritated because, okay, I'll go vote for Carly.
Yeah, right. Oh, I see. So the thing is that if they have a vagina, you vote for them? Okay, I should have voted for Michelle Bachmann then. Or, yeah, Carly Fiorina.
You all should have been Peyton girl. I mean, you know, Sarah Palin girl. No, these women are not representing us appropriately.
Anyway, but it is true. Hillary is and was and has been a feminist. She's broken through. She's this and that. She's competent. All the things you were saying about her before. So it's not like Michelle Bachmann or Fiorina. But this idea that that is the... I mean, I'll let Denise, who emailed me about this, say, I am so happy you talked about that. What Gloria Steinem said is insulting. It shocked me. Madeleine Albright's quote is awful, too. I can't believe either of them would talk to anyone, let alone young women, like that. There are reasons for Bernie support among young people in general. How could these two smart women be so wrong-headed? I've thought for years that Hillary should be president. If I were voting this moment, I would lean to Bernie, but I'm not sure. I wish Hillary would do or say something that would assure me that she's the right choice. She gets close, but he beats her every time because he says what I want her to say. I am really disappointed with Steinem and Albright. They did nothing to make Hillary look better, and they insulted young women. Yep. Yep.
Yeah, I totally agree.
With friends like that. So,
well, and I mean, Steinem's already backpedaled and apologized.
Yes, she has.
I mean, what did she think she meant? She thought, you know, she meant exactly what she said.
She flat out said that young women were voting for Sanders because that the young men were there, and
that's where the boys were. That's where the boys were, and that is the most regressive thing.
I mean, I can't believe
how could that.
How could that come out of her head? How? And then her apology is she misspoke. Oh, no.
No, you told us what you think, that young women have not a thought in their heads, in their pretty little heads, but boys. That's what our leading feminist said.
Unbelievable.
And it's not true. It's insulting. And they have every right to do what the feminist movement was always about, which is using their own brains to make their own
choices. Hey, don't let anybody, old ladies or men, anybody, tell you how to vote. Jesus. Okay. Yeah, it's going to be...
Being a woman is not an automatic qualification for anything, just like it shouldn't be an automatic disqualification.
Yeah, but the fact is they are... But, Suze, they are talking about a woman that is eminently qualified, as you said earlier.
Of course they are.
I mean, it's not like they're saying, if it's got a vagina, vote for it. That's not what they're saying. They're saying this woman.
And given that this woman, who I do think is very qualified, is attempting to make a run for the president, I'm going to vote for her because, on top of that, I do think it's time for this country to have a woman. At that point, I added on top.
You know, it's huge. You know, I think we don't feel that way as much anymore because the fact that we elected Barack Obama twice, we're thinking, and nobody's really saying anything about Hillary as a woman being like a negative. It's like we feel we've already done it.
We've done that.
Yeah, like, you know, come on, we got to.
We've done something so bad that anything else couldn't be as
that's
bad.
That's right. We elected a black Muslim, for God's sakes. Of course we'd elect a female Methodist.
To me, that's how I pretty much tip between Bernie and Hillary. Because if you look at it practically and look at what any next president can hope to accomplish, I got to put them even. And I think she's a better leader to the world. And I think then you put beside she's a woman. And I'm voting
all right.
That one.
Okay. Caller. We got to call. Hello.
Hey, Lynn.
Yeah.
George from Moon. Long time no talk.
Hey, yeah, George. Hi.
Okay. My take on this, because I saw it, I saw it on HBO, and
You mean you saw Gloria on Mara's show?
Yeah. And I've fallen Mara every now and then. But it surprised me too. But she did say other things that were very good and everything, but that even Mara was shocked.
It was shocking. It was shocking.
Yeah, it was. And my daughter, who I would call a millennial, agreed with me that this was really shocking for somebody, a pioneer like Gloria Steinem, to be saying something like this.
The most sexist thing you could say.
Right. No, here's my take on it. Number one, and of course Madeleine Albright too. What this is about is two things. The inauguration of Hillary Clinton to be the first woman president. This is the steam machine of the older feminists, okay? They want to make history now. I'm not saying all the old feminists. I'm saying a certain minority of them in the power structure want to inaugurate her and put the icing and the cap on the cake of their pioneering efforts.
Before they die.
And it's making them blind
yeah.
to the continuing issues. Now, second thing is, there's a natural generational stress here that always occurs between old and young.
Exactly.
And the younger seem, the good ones anyway, seem to catch on to the things that they want to change. The older ones become more encrusted with wanting to keep secure the things they want or they fought
for. That they have, yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
So that's my take. Those
I think
two
that's...
things are key to mm-hmm. understanding this. I think.
Okay. I think that's.
But they want her. They want to inaugurate her.
Yeah.
And they're so driven by that they're missing the continuing battle that women have.
Yeah.
That's the shame of it.
Okay. Hey, thank you.
Yes. Okay.
Good to hear
Bye.
From you. Bye. Oh, well. This is. I got to tell you. This election is fascinating.
Yes, it is.
On both sides. Did you see Rubio did it again?
What, to repeat the same thing six times?
Yes, no, he didn't do it six times. But after that, you know, again, almost as strange as seeing Gloria Steinem say that sexist thing, Rubio's, you know, playing right into Chris Christie's hands and Saturday's...
It's like somebody did it as a Saturday night.
I know! You wouldn't even believe it, but listen to what he did last night. I'm going to read verbatim what he said. I've seen it on TV, too. But he, within 4 or 5 sentences, absolutely does a repeat of what he had just... Listen to this. We are taking our message to families that are struggling to raise their children in the 21st century, because as you saw, Jeanette and I are raising our 4 children in the 21st century, and we know how hard it's become to instill our values in our kids instead of the values they try to ram down our throats. In the 21st century, it's becoming harder than ever to instill in your children with the values they teach in our home and in our church instead of the values that they try to ram down our throats in movie. Susan, that's what he said. He just repeated almost verbatim. Is that not bizarre?
It's bizarre.
Okay. Caller. Hello. Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi. Hey, Lynn, I'll make this quick. The problem, too, with the Hillary Clinton and on the other side of Republicans, you probably already said this, but the Democrats weren't really satisfied with what Obama did. So they're like, you know what, we're going to throw something new in here and go to Bernie. Same way with Trump. The Republicans aren't happy, you know, what like McCain and the ones we put up, Romney. So they're going to go to Trump. And that's the problem. They want to go outside the box, as they say.
They want to upset the apple cart because they're pissed off. They
right.
see what's going on. They see Hillary as a continuation of everything, of, you know, a Democratic Party that's better than the Republicans, but still, you know, does the bidding of their corporate masters pretty much. Yeah. Yeah.
And myself, I'm not really satisfied with Obama, but, you know, he didn't do bad. But I could see where you could get that way, real easy. But
sure.
You got to use your head and not vote a Republican, and because the guy can't make it. I mean, got to use common sense.
Okay, so you don't see Bernie as winning in general.
I really don't. I'm like you. I don't see them voting a socialist.
I mean, my God, we were just talking. You know, we were just talking about a socialist. We were just talking about a woman, and I was saying, well, maybe we've gotten beyond all that because we elected a black guy. But in fact, Bernie is also a Jew. And I mean, for a lot of people, I got news for you, that's a disqualifier. Although they tend to be the same people that a socialist would be a disqualifier for, but not all. You add Jewish and socialist together, and you're giving away just tons and tons and tons of votes for people who can't go there. Without a doubt. And people who aren't acknowledging that are not being honest.
I hope she tightens up the race in New Hampshire, too, just to make it so it don't look as bad, you know. You're going to lose.
Yeah.
But maybe not as bad. Maybe.
We'll see. It's still early, as they say.
It's still early.
Yes. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Good to hear from you.
Bye.
Bye. So, Suze.
Yeah.
You didn't happen to see... While you were perusing the New York Times, did you happen to see David Brooks?
No, I didn't.
Well, David Brooks, as you know, is a Republican, although of a moderate stripe.
He's been going nuts and begging people to come to this episode.
I know he is. Well, listen, you think he's going nuts.
For several weeks now. I mean, he's just...
Listen to this.
What did he write today?
Listen to this. It's titled...
Poor guy.
It's titled... It's titled, I Miss Barack Obama.
I know.
Okay, here's what he says in part. He said, because what made me think of this is because the caller said that, you know, even a lot of Democrats say, well, Obama didn't do it, you know, we got to do Sanders. Okay, so here's what David Brooks says. As this primary season has gone along, a strange sensation has come over me. I miss Barack Obama. Many of the traits of character and leadership that Obama possesses and that maybe we have taken too much for granted have suddenly gone missing or are in he's saying all the things that we sort of like don't even notice about him, the fact that he's an adult, that he has dignity, that he's, you know, all these things, that his character is above reproach, all this stuff. And he says the first and most important of the things that are in short supply with the current crop is basic integrity. The Obama administration has been remarkably scandal-free. That is so true. And not for any, you know, lack, I'm sure, of Republicans digging around desperately trying to find scandal. Think of the way Iran-Contra or the Lewinsky scandal swallowed years of the presidencies of Reagan and Clinton. Obama and his staff have generally behaved with basic rectitude. Hillary Clinton is constantly having to hold these defensive press conferences when she's trying to explain away some vaguely shady shortcut she's taken or decision she's made. But Obama has not had to do that. He and his wife have not only displayed superior integrity themselves, they have mostly attracted and hired people with high personal standards as well. And then he talks about how there are all sorts of unsightly characters floating around in Hillary's campaign, in the campaigns of these other people. He's looking at that and he's thinking, oh, God. And then he ends with Obama radiates an ethos of integrity, humanity, good manners, and elegance that I'm already beginning to miss and that I suspect we will all miss regardless of who replaces him. He's already thinking wistfully of looking back and realizing what we had even while we were carping.
What we abused for 8 years.
Yeah, while we were carping about it.
He said that all along. Yeah, he's. Yeah. I've been saying for 7.5 years now. Have you noticed that David Brooks seems to really like Obama?
Well, David Brooks is undergoing a total. David Brooks is, you know, he's sort of going off to la la. I expect him to take up with the Maharishi any moment, and you know, he's just having.
Well, he's a dinosaur. He's a moderate Republican,
and he's a spiritual man too. Yeah. I mean, what I'm saying is he's looking for greater meaning. He's trying to be a better person. He writes openly about that, trying to be better. Yeah. He does. How he can still be a Republican, I don't know. Okay, we've got to catch up on some emails here. Gigi says, I think Madeline and Gloria are both feeling their mortality, and they can't believe that, once again, a highly qualified woman may not be elected. I'm with Susan. Although I like a lot of what Bernie says, Hillary's going to get my vote. She is, to my mind, more qualified. And yes, she happens to be female, and it's time for a female in our country to be president, in our time. Okay. Well said. Roger writes, my wife and I frequently have these conversations about Bernie versus Hillary. She wants to see a woman president, as do I. But she says Hillary's more likely to beat any of the Republicans. I'm sick and tired of Clintons and Bushes. Well, that's another thing, too. Bernie's message really speaks to my heart and my head. Yes, Hillary's more electable, but she brings no excitement. Bernie's rousing of young people is exactly what we need. Get rid of the Republican majority in Congress and end Republican-light Democrats. Bernie's right. We need a political revolution. Yeah, but...
Okay, well, that's a big order for one election cycle.
Yeah, let's get that.
You know, or you lose all.
Yeah.
Or you lose all. You have to be strategic. You absolutely have to be strategic.
Okay, Suze, but then Roger goes on. Hillary's right in that Congress won't pass anything Bernie wants. But guess what? They aren't going to pass anything she wants either. When Republicans aren't...
I don't know that that's true.
Well, I don't know. Why would they? They're not going to be any different with her than they are with Obama. When Republicans aren't trying to repeal Obamacare for the 900th time, they'll be busy investigating and trying to impeach her. I mean, I agree with him. I mean, that's what they'll do. They'll be having, and Hillary, unlike Obama, will be giving them lots of ammo. It's just the way the Clintons operate. Sorry. Young people, get out there and not just vote for Bernie. Get rid of the GOP Congress, says Roger. Well, but we ain't going to do that this time because of gerrymandering. Because of all they own. I mean, the very few seats that are even in play.
You have to be strategic. You have to be unemotional and strategic. And you have to look at what your best chances are to get any part of what it is that we need to get. And the most important thing that we need to get is control of the Supreme Court. And I just don't go anywhere but that, so I'm going to pick a candidate that I think has the best chance of taking the whole thing. And my heart has very little to do with it. My head's going to tell me what to do.
Well, I'm letting my heart have some fun right now. My head is still working, but...
Well, you guys get to do whatever you want. I'll vote for the Democrat.
Well,
I'm just saying, I think that that Hillary they're both not great candidates to take at all because they both have serious issues in a greater election.
Ron wrote me a real long bit, very interesting stuff, but I'll just read his conclusion to you. If you or your listeners are dreaming of Bernie, please remember the Democrats outnumber the Republicans, but they never show up for the elections unless it's a presidency that's up for grabs, which is we ain't going to remake the Congress because our people only vote every 4 years. It's true. If these folks, he writes, are really serious about corporate control, they would show up and gerrymander all these election districts lost to Republicans. If they did this, then Bernie would have a case. That's true. Democrats, and you're talking about strategy, until Democrats decide that there's more than the election of the presidency, we're going to continue to probably hold the presidency, but have... not much sway in the legislative branch. And if you're looking to remake things, I hate to tell you, that's where it happens, in the Congress. And...
Well, you know, this gets us back to what we're always talking about how you have to vote in every single stupid little election.
But people don't.
Your school board election,
right.
your county council elections,
right,
your, you know, state legislature elections. They all...
Because those things funnel up. They funnel up. That's how people, you know...
That's how people walk up the ladder.
That's right.
Well, that's how they get where they're going.
Right.
And the smaller the office, the more it directly affects you anyway.
Yes, yes,
Why
yes.
Why wouldn't you be paying?
Exactly again? Right. But try telling that to people. We got a call. Hello. Hi.
Hey, Lynn.
Hi.
I feel very strongly about this election, and I'm going to try to remain calm because.
I know that feeling. Well, good luck to you.
Well. I am a Democrat. I am more of a centrist Democrat.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the left wing of the party really needs to be careful by assuming that just because that they feel this way about Bernie, that a lot of the other Democrats feel this way about Bernie as well. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
I mean, I'm...
So you don't like you don't like Bernie?
Quite frankly, no.
And what he says doesn't resonate with you at all?
When he first started, it did, because it was in general terms. Now that the election has been going on and on, I want to know, how are you going to pay for this $1.8 trillion in spending? Because you're not going to get all that money just from taxing the top 1%. I want to know specifically, what are your tax plans? And I understand if you're 20 years old and you're in college and you don't have a job yet, those aren't as concerning to you. I'm a 30-year-old guy. I'm a middle-income guy. I'm single. I don't have any tax write-offs. I want to know how much money I'm going to be paying under your plan.
Okay, but
I suspect with him it's going to be a lot more.
Oh, yeah, it would be definitely a lot more. But he's saying you'll pay in a lot more, but wow, look what I'm going to give you back for that. I'm going to give you true free access to health care. I'm going to give you free college. But here, I just want to add on your side. You can't change a tax law without the Congress changing
exactly.
It.
You need 218 votes in the House, and you need, you know, practically 300. You know, you need every single senator to sign on to something these days.
And there's no way any of Bernie's tax plans would get through the Congress.
But for some reason, when you try to explain this to Bernie supporters. As a Clinton supporter, suddenly you're a right-wing troll and a thug and a Republican in disguise.
You know, see, that's got to stop. It's got to stop. And I said yesterday, I don't care which side you come down on, I'm going to respect where you are in the Democratic side. On the Republican side, I'm not necessarily going to respect who you're supporting. But both, I will respect Democrats or anybody, independents, voting for either Hillary or Bernie. And I understand why, but I completely understand what you're saying. But see, Bernie's hopes do speak to my heart so much
right.
that it's hard not to get emotional.
I wish
we could see that. But since everything he's talking about requires legislative action,
right.
and we're looking at a Congress that is like, you know, out of the dark ages, it ain't going to happen.
But can I just say that, and obviously I'm speaking from my perspective as a more centrist, moderate Democrat. By the way, by no means am I a Republican. I mean, those people are off the deep end. When he goes through his whole spiel, mm-hmm. to me, it sounds like he's just telling you guys every single thing you want to hear.
Well, that's, yes. Yeah. It's the audacity of hope.
But I'm sure now in his case it seems like he does actually believe that.
He does.
But on the same side, if you're running against Hillary Clinton, there's no other way that you could run against her except to go way out to the left.
This is true.
So whether or not he means it or not, it's in his best interest. Anyway, and I also want to say a lot of these people who are for him, I've noticed that the campaign people, these are the same type of people who have been angry at Obama since 2009, but they're hanging all of the things that they don't like about what Obama did on Clinton. when they should really have the balls to attack Obama directly. But of course they can't do that because he's highly popular within the party.
Okay. Well, listen, you got to pace yourself because you're in for a rough,
I know.
A bumpy 9-month ride.
Well, I'm sorry, Lynn. I'll let you go.
No. I'm not. I really appreciate your call and hearing from you. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay. Goodbye.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Oh, man.
Yeah, I don't want us splitting.
Oh, it's gonna get ugly, Suze. Suze, do you remember what it was like the last in 2008? Because I sure do.
Yeah, I do.
With Hillary and Clinton. I mean Hillary and Obama. Man, yeah. I cannot tell you how many enraged women told me they'd never listen to me again, that I was a traitor, that I was a this, that. I mean, it got so ugly. And there's no reason to believe it won't get ugly again. It already is getting ugly. It's too bad. It's too bad we can't just allow for everybody to have their point of view. Why are we so? It's because of talk.
Yeah, why can't
it's talk radio.
And why can't we enjoy the intellectual thought process? Let's try and be, grown-ups and think it through. Think it through.
Exactly. And as you said, it was really pretty, I thought, wonderful, that last debate with the Democratic debate, with those two smart cookies going back and forth.
The level of discourse.
Yeah.
Sit there and learn.
Yeah.
I mean, sit there and learn. It's a process. Just learn. And honestly, what I know at this point is I would be okay with either one of those candidates, and I'd work my butt off for either one of them. But, I'm falling one way. I can certainly understand people falling the other.
Okay, Suze, let's say, and I don't think it will happen, that Bernie gets the nomination. If that looks like it's happening, Michael Bloomberg is going to jump in as a third-party candidate.
Of course he is.
Would you consider Bloomberg?
I'd have to consider Bloomberg because, again, I'd have to make the decision about who had the best shot. If Bloomberg jumps in at that point, we've got President Trump.
Well, you're assuming
and
that.
You're
assuming Trump. You really think Trump's going to get the nomination?
I don't know.
No, we don't know about that.
Trump is symbolic of any one of those clowns.
There was a funny
a
moment. There was a funny little thing in the Times. You probably, I don't know if you saw it, about. So Trump's at a Best Western, which for him is probably akin to having his fingernails pulled out one by one. Trump's at
an outhouse.
Trump's at a Best Western in Manchester, and he's coming out, and the scrum of reporters and the security guys, Secret Service shoving and blah blah blah, and one of the reporters there is this old war horse from WCBS in New York, a woman named Marcia Kramer. And, I mean, she's a tough New York reporter. And all the reporters are, Donald, Mr. Trump, Mr. Trump. And she wins over all of them. She gets his attention. As he's moving toward her, she says very loudly, "Could you let go of my breast, please?" Trump turns. What? And she said that one of the security guys trying to shove her had his hand on her boob. And so Trump comes right over, and she gets to ask him questions, and she got some great responses like, "Jeb's a stiff." Yeah. You know, some really, stop the presses.
Real pithy stuff.
Right? Yeah, stop the presses. Trump just said, "Jeb's a stiff." Anyway, and while Trump was going, he said to her, hey, this is U.S. government security, you know, not my guys, okay? And on he went. But that's a smart cookie, would you? I mean, assuming she did it, she timed it. Let go of my breast! Bang. Every head turns. Right. That would get, you know, that would end up coming out of the chorus of, Mr. Trump, I love my breast! Smart.
Very smart.
Very smart.
Although, you know, maybe he had her hand on her breast and it was just a perfect opportunity to, you know, it all just happened because... I've been in a similar situation and yelled similar things in great crowds and brought everything to a stop. And, you know, that's just, it might just have been her reaction.
I forget, Susan, what you're referencing.
Well, my husband and I lived in New York and as a young woman and I was...
Right.
Living at 168th and Broadway and working at the other end of Manhattan.
On Wall Street.
And I would
You'll never get
take
elected.
The A train.
Yeah.
No, I would take the A train from one end of Manhattan to the other every day with a bunch of guys in suits smashed in like a sardine. And I got used to, you know, people holding on to inappropriate parts of my body. You know, I just sort of didn't count. But one day I noticed that some man, and I couldn't tell who the arm belonged to, but some man had placed his hand in between my legs frontally.
Well, how would that even happen? I mean, you're not...
Well, duh. So I just found myself saying, will the man who has his hand in my crotch please remove it?
And did he?
And immediately there was a circle in this, you know, sandwiched in people. There was a circle of about 6 feet all around me.
That's something to remember in tight circumstances.
The train stopped, and I, slight humiliation got off the train, but I did. That was the day that I went into the president of the company and demanded a car because I had been sexually assaulted daily on my way to and from.
Oh, demanded a car. Come on.
I did. I got it. I did. I got a taxi.
Oh, he said take the taxi.
He said he'd pay for, you know, a taxi. And that, dear sister, is how I met Hugh Downs.
Hugh Downs?
Don't you remember Hugh Downs?
Well, how could you not remember him? He was on television since 1902. Is he still around?
You interviewed him. No, but you interviewed him once in my apartment after a year or so, moved more midtown, and it shared a block with the ABC studio.
Oh, right,
in which
right.
Hugh Downs did...
Right.
What, 2020 or whatever?
I don't know. He's done every show in the... Yeah.
But you had interviewed him recently during this... No, you interviewed him a few years later. I can't remember.
I don't remember interviewing.
I suddenly realized that you arrived at across the street every morning just about the time...
You left.
I wanted to go to work.
Yeah.
So I started waiting for his cab because there was always a cab.
I see. So
he started holding his... He started holding his cab for me if I was a little late.
That's cute. He was a nice guy.
That's a good story. Anyway, we digress.
Yeah.
And he asked you what happened to me because I disappeared one day.
Oh, really? I don't remember that. I remember, I remember him fondly, but I don't, whatever. This is so odd, and this has nothing to do with anything. I'm just throwing it out there. So, you know, I get the Week magazine just in case there's something I
mm-hmm.
missed.
Mm-hmm.
Usually there isn't, but
mm-hmm.
here's a case in point. In this week's The Week, it says, this is something that happened, it says, right near Pittsburgh. Now, it's odd when a story makes its way into a national publication about something that happens in your own city or near, and... It's the first you've heard of it. So I'm just putting this out there. And if any of you heard this before, was this covered and local? How would they? Okay, here it is. It's just a little light story. It's nothing horrible. In fact, it's under their little, they have a little thing called It Wasn't All Bad. And this is where they...
Oh, well, that's nice.
Yes, they have. For people who want, as you said, you went through the New York Times today and you worked yourself up into a, you know, a state of rage or whatever. But this is the kind of news you go looking for. Here it is. When trucker Matthew Collins jackknifed his truck on a snow-covered highway near Pittsburgh and was left dangling in his cab over the edge of a precipice, a group of motorists linked arms and came to his rescue. Within seconds of the accident, drivers started pulling over and instinctively formed a human chain. Arm in arm, the selfless strangers inched their way down the slope and toward the smoking wreckage and pulled the injured trucker to safety. That's a nice story, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a very nice story.
Why wouldn't I have heard of that? If it happened in Pittsburgh.
I don't know.
Anyone, I'm just putting
and
it out there.
How do we know that it was instinctive? How do we know it was instinctive that this line of strangers came together like you know, bacteria and if yes, you know what I mean?
You know the altruistic gene.
I bet you someone said, come on, let's link arms.
Well, that was according to, you know, who knows? Who knows? And then, here, I'll give you, because you need a good, okay, you want, because let me give you the other nice story here, okay? And this one didn't happen in Pittsburgh, but this one's pretty remarkable and also shows altruism, but this is species to species, okay? A guy, a free diver, that means what? He's just holding his breath. A free diver swimming off the coast of Florida hypnotized a 10-foot shark and extracted a large fishing hook that was stuck in the shark's mouth, all while holding his breath. 32-year-old Michael DeMellis pacified the shark by placing his hands on either side of the shark's snout, a technique called tonic immobility. The self-employed diver filmed himself, gently removing the stainless steel hook from the shark and hopes the footage will improve people's understanding of these creatures. I'm looking at a picture.
Okay. Where's the camera? Is it on his mask or something?
Well, it might have been, but I'm looking at a picture that shows him and the shark, so somebody else had to have been filming him doing this wonderful thing.
How would he know that there was a shark in that spot?
How would he know there was a shark with a hook in its...
Such that he would bring a cameraman and go down there.
And I suppose you think the moon landing was faked?
No. I don't. I'm just asking questions.
Well, I have to admit it.
This guy has more than the usual number of eyes a camera, and he knew he was going to run into this shark. So what, did he have it on a leash?
I don't know. You see what a cynic you become, Susan. I've shared with you two of the nice stories under the It Wasn't All Bad on this week, and both you're cynically responding to. As
I am cynically responding. It's the age of the internet.
Yeah. So we go for three? You want to hear the third and final good news story?
Sure.
Okay. Poke holes in this one. At 101.
Curious.
Huh?
So I'm just curious.
Okay. At 101, Richard Mann is more active than many people a quarter of his age. the retired post office clerk, still shovels.
He shovels snow. I know about this guy.
St. Paul, Minnesota.
Guy on TV. Yeah.
He clears his neighbors. He shovels snow of his neighbors. Everybody. He's 101. He says, "I do it because it's necessary." He starts each day with a breakfast of bacon and eggs. Yeah! Says routine exercise and walks around the neighborhood have helped keep him in good health. But he also attributes his long life to fine wine, women, and getting plenty of rest. God bless him. Can't say nothing bad about that. Right?
No, and good exercise. No, it's good for him. Cold weather preserved.
It reminds me of the story Mom told about, oh, God, what was her name? One of her friends, I think now deceased, who was, it's not one of the major friends. I'm just blanking on the name. She told me that she had broken her hip. And this woman was like 98, 99 years old. And she said so-and-so had broken her hip. I said, uh-oh. Well, I said, how'd she do it? She said, well, she was out shoveling her driveway. And you know what? Why can't I? It'll come to me after the show. And it didn't take her down. That she came back from the hip and was fine, although I don't think she shoveled her driveway anymore.
No, but
since gone.
Well, but she was. It was the end of a good run. I wish I knew what you were talking about.
I'll tell you
that the last time I was in Green Bay, you know, right before we were in December, and I got there right about 2 hours ahead of a 10-inch snow, and had to get the car shoveled out, and mom's snow guy was snowed in. Which I tried to tell Mom was not a good sign that this was her snow guy. And,
you know, he was snowed in.
How can you have a snow guy that can't get out of his own driveway?
Yeah, not a good sign.
No, so I had to shovel myself out.
Well, sure.
All the neighbors, you know, the neighbor across the street shows up. I mean, I got myself out enough. You know, I shoveled the wall, the snow down the street left.
Yeah.
And I was just going to back through the rest. And nope, I look out the window, and there's the neighbor out there shoveling like frantically. He cleared all the way out behind me in 5 minutes.
God bless him.
This isn't any snowblower stuff either. This is a man with a shovel.
Yeah. God bless him. Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. Well, what was I going to tell you? Oh, Suze, I still haven't talked about this, but I'm just taking. Should women register for the draft now?
Absolutely.
Yep, me too. I agree too.
Absolutely. Why is there any discussion about
that? You know what's interesting? That question was asked at a Republican debate this week somewhere, and I thought, oh boy, I can't wait to hear this. And the first two, I didn't hear the rest, but the two people who responded to it. Without the two Republicans said yes. I think it was Rubio.
Absolutely.
Said yes. And maybe Christie. I don't know. But I was surprised. Boy, how far we've come, huh? Hey, by the way, someone is letting us know that Hugh Downs is still alive.
Nice man.
Yeah, nice man. Sweet guy. It was clear he was a sweet guy. I mean, I think that's why he was so, you know, he wasn't handsome. He was very low key, sort of fair. And, you know, he was just you could tell a decent soul, right?
But he really was. I mean, there was
a
man every morning
holding
a
cab
for a total stranger.
Yeah. Well,
young woman, you know.
But you weren't strange after a while because you had a routine.
Right.
Yeah, that's sweet. Okay, Kurt is saying Bernie can win. All right, we'll hear you out here, Kurt. Bernie can win. After all, Obama won handily twice. Bernie would face some problems, but can you conceive of the Obama voter who would turn their back on the Democrats because Sanders got the nomination?
No. Absolutely not. If Sanders gets the nomination, I vote for him.
Okay, he goes on. Are there Obama voters who are going to vote for Trump or Cruz or Rubio? No. They might sit it out. That's what you're... There's another possibility. I'll sit it out. Or if Bloomberg gets in, I'll vote for him because he's frankly not a Republican anyway. He's just a moderate corporatist pragmatist who showed he was capable in his tenure in New York. Okay, Kurt, back to Kurt. Time was when various philosophical litmus tests divided the Democratic Party. These days, it's the Republicans that have that problem. Hillary and Bernie are, so far, being careful not to attack each other and seem savvy to the importance of preserving party unity. The difference between them is not in basic philosophy, but in the pragmatism of their approaches. I'll vote my conscience in the primary. I'll vote Democrat in November. That's sort of what I'm thinking I'll do. But if you vote your conscience in the primary, it's conceivable if everybody does that, you end up with Sanders winning or a weakened Hillary. I think we'll find out as the primaries go on that Sanders' socialism leaves a lot of Democrats cold. That's what I'm going to bet. People who long ago drank the Kool-Aid that's been out there in the U.S. since the Red Scare and the Red baiting. In fact, we've been baiting Red since 1917. So, I don't know.
Yeah, I think it's an issue, but I mean, I would hope that Democrats would see the importance of sticking to the party.
I'm sticking to the party. Oh, that's I'm sticking to the union. You know that song? No. No.
Yeah, I do actually. I had to take it out of your rendition and replay it in my head.
Oh, you can't blame me. I'm sticking to the union. I'm sticking to the union. I'm sticking to the union. That's it, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you can't blame me. I'm sticking to the union. I'm sticking to the union till the day I die. Those are the kind of lyrics I like. Lyrics you can remember. Those are sort of like Marco Rubio lyrics. Okay. Oh dear God in heaven. Okay, oh Suze. I've been wanting to. So
yes.
Did you watch the boring Super Bowl game?
I watched parts of it.
Yeah,
yes.
Me too. Did you see the halftime?
I watched parts of it, yes.
Well, I've been meaning to say this because I find now that Fox News and Rush Limbaugh and Rudy Giuliani and round up the usual lunatics are appalled at the halftime.
Why?
Limbaugh said he didn't know this was not my country, he said. All he saw were these black women scantily clad, shaking their tushes at him. And then Bruno Mars and his gang looking a little suspicious too. And of course, totally showing up the white bread.
Do you want to hear your mother's review of it?
Yeah, what'd she say?
She hated Coldplay. I mean, I heard her in there going, who are these people? What are they doing here? They're just terrible. And then out comes Bruno.
Yeah.
And she was happy as a clam.
Yeah, because he's such a performer.
Now this is something.
Yeah. So she had the right. So she was right.
Beyonce, and she liked Beyonce, too.
Right.
She just thought Coldplay was terrible and didn't understand why they were, why you know, any of them were there.
So all these, you know, it was so classic. It was two black performers and the white guy. And the white guy was a joke. A joke compared.
Well, but that's a setup because there are white guys that wouldn't have been a joke. Who likes Coldplay, I'd like to know.
I don't know. Gwyneth Paltrow?
No, she
oh, no, but they, Suits. Yeah, but no, they had Don't they have a, they were meaningfully disengaged or something? Do you remember?
They were consciously uncoupled.
Consciously uncoupled.
Uncoupled, yeah.
God, I can't stand her.
No, I can't either. She was there, too.
Okay, so, but I'm telling you, they're all freaking out. They are freaking out. They can't, they're so racist. They're so freaked out
by
blacks.
Well, they are, and I mean, that song, that's, song is a feminist, you know.
Yeah, feminist and anti. I mean, it's. Oh, we got a call. Hey, hello. Hello, hello.
Hey, this is Lynn Cullen.
This is she.
Hi, Lynn. This is Christina Hartman calling. I'm running for U.S. Congress in an open seat here in Pennsylvania. And I was calling today because I understand that you're invested in the makeup of Congress. And I wondered if you had a minute for me to tell me about my race.
Well, it's a bad time for you to call because I've only got literally 1 minute left. What open seat in Congress?
It's Pennsylvania 16, so Joe Pitt's a seat, but he's retiring.
And tell us geographically where that is?
Lancaster, Chester, and Berks counties.
But why would you tell us? We can't vote in that.
Because this is an important issue for Democrats across the nation to get one more seat in the House.
Well, I'm for that, but from where you're geographically suggesting that your district is, that's the part of Pennsylvania that we liken to Mississippi.
That's true, but we've seen a lot of demographic changes over the past 20 years. We're younger and more diverse than ever before. We were gerrymandered in 2012 in a way that actually helped the Democrats, and so we've got a lot of things going in our favor this season.
Okay, so you sound young. How can I ask your age?
Sure, I'm 38 years old.
Oh, okay. And what other offices have you held, any?
I have not held office before, but I've worked in Washington and overseas for policy advocacy organizations for 16 years.
Well, listen, I my show is over. That's the problem. Calling? But let me just say, good for you. Good for you. Good luck to you. And now that you've put yourself on my radar, I'll make a point of following you.
Well,
but I can't vote for you, dear. I can't vote.
I know. But also, we accept contributions from folks around the state and the nation.
Okay. All right.
Grateful for your support.
All right. Tell us your name again.
Christina Hartman.
Christina Hartman. Good luck, Christina.
Thanks so much, Lynn. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Take care.
Bye-bye. All right. Well, there's a young woman doing it.
You bet.
Doomed.
Yeah.
Doomed. I mean, Lancaster County?
Maybe
give me
not.
A break. That's the Amish. Suze. It's rural. It's... God bless her. Okay. So that's it, guys. I gotta go see Susan and my mom. I gotta get to California. And I'm...
Dear sister, give a call off air because I'd like to talk to you.
I'm sure that's true. Later today, perhaps. Okay?
Okay.
All right.
Bye.
And bye, Suze. Thanks. And guys, I'll be back a week from tomorrow, I guess. Yeah, a week from tomorrow. Goodbye. I'll miss you. And here's what's going to happen. A lot of news. It always happens when I take a week off. All kinds of stuff that I want to talk about. It's bound to happen. So you're in for a good news week. I betcha. Bye.
Lynn Cullen Live, Monday through Friday from 10 a.m. to 11 a.m. and archived at pghcitypaper.com. The opinions expressed on Lynn Cullen Live are those of the host and do not necessarily reflect the viewpoints of Pittsburgh City Paper, Steel City Media, and its advertisers.